morning. Members of the university family, alumni, and friends, welcome to the 2015 opening convocation of the University of the District of Columbia. Please rise for the presentation of colors by the Capitol Guard Youth Challenge Color Guard, followed by the singing of the national anthem led by the UDC Chorale under the direction of Professor Richard Odom with Dr. Thomas Licata on piano. After the anthem, please remain standing as Reverend George E. Holmes of President Barack Obama's National Clergy Leadership Group gives the invocation. He will be followed by Tatiana Calhoun, Miss UDC, who will give the welcome.
Bishop once said, there are two ways for a leader to go through life. Number one, as a thermometer, and number two, as a thermostat. A thermometer tells the temperature, measures the climate, but a thermostat sets the tone, creates the climate. And that is who you are, the University of the District of Columbia. You are the thermostat, and by your mere presence here at this 2015 opening convocation, you are setting the tone, creating the climate for the District of Columbia, United States of America, and the world. Let us pray. Almighty God, we humbly come before you and ask that you bless these guardians of hope in higher education, trustees of a brighter future, and workers in God's will as they tirelessly work toward bringing their Vision 2020 plan into focus. Father God, in his inaugural year and beyond, bless President Robert Mason Jr. Esquire, his immediate family and his academic family, his vision and his leadership. Lord God, we pray for synergistic, communal, and collegiate relationships between the President's office, the Board of Trustees, students, faculty, and alumni of all six schools and colleges. Almighty Father, please align the University of the District of Columbia with global community partners who share their vision for academic development in the nation's capital and beyond. Father God, We ask that you allow this great institution to expand its territory, grow its infrastructure, and broaden its reach. May the student enrollment swell exponentially beyond the 5,100. May the number of undergraduate and graduate degree and certificate programs increase past 68. May the number of talented faculty grow beyond 257. And may the diversity at this great institution proliferate to include more than the 64 countries currently represented. And let not any obstacle stand in their way of achieving the greatness you may have predestined and preordained for them. Now, Lord God, please continue to provide clarity of mind, soundness of judgment, courageousness of spirit to the leadership and faculty of this institution of higher learning. Please bless the students of this historical university so their futures are as bright as the stars you so miraculously hung in the sky. Father God, keep this university in the hollow of your hands and in good health financially, socially, and academically. We thank you for all that you have done in the past 160 plus years, and we ask that you never leave our sides as we march forward together to celebrate 160 more years. Now, God, in closing, we, the stakeholders, pray in the words of President John Fitzgerald Kennedy, let us not ask UDC what UDC can do for us, but rather, God, let us ask what we, the stakeholders, can do for our University of the District of Columbia. Now, God, may you continue to bless the great thermostats here, the University of the District of Columbia, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. And may all of God's children say amen and amen.
Good morning. My name is Tatiana Calhoun, and I am your Miss University of the District of Columbia, and I am here to bring greetings today on behalf of the student body here at UDC. Here at the university, we focus on vision, and what better way to promote vision than with Vision 2020, a plan used to fulfill all the plans here at the university. It is a roadmap for renewal, innovation, success, and sustainability. The university will create an environment that empowers students to take advantage of the opportunities afforded to them through investment, through students, and alumni support. The university will support faculty members' research, outreach, and innovation in addressing the social, economic, health, and cultural needs of the District of Columbia's residents. And with the new addition of President Ronald Mason, things can only get better from here. So we look forward to the support of the faculty, the students, and the community to help him bring success to our university. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, today we celebrate the formal opening of the University of the District of Columbia for academic year 2015-16. Our theme this year is Journey to 2020. Later, President Mason will outline steps that the university plans to take to help us to reach Vision 2020. I ask at this time that all cell phones and pagers are turned off or put on vibrate. We are delighted to extend another welcome to our freshmen and to transfer students. I ask that they stand and be recognized. This year's Convocation Committee was chaired by Dr. Elgloria Harrison of the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences, and Dr. Sandra Jowers Barber of the University of the District of Columbia Community College. I ask that they stand, and I extend to them thanks for their leadership in planning this activity. Today's convocation will be aired on UDC-TV, Comcast Channel 98, Verizon and RCN Channel 19. At this time, I am pleased to introduce some of our special guests. I'd like for any elected officials or members of the federal or DC government to please stand. Members of the Board of Trustees. The President's Cabinet and the Deans. Representing the UDC National Alumni Society, Mr. McKee Fox. And finally, but most importantly, our student leaders. Diane Hawkins, President of the Community College. Jonice Barnes, President of the Undergraduate Student Government Association. Brandon Wallace, President of the David A. Clark School of Law Student Bar Association. I would also like to recognize Professor Arlene Kingberry, President of the Faculty Senate. Special recognition and a personal thanks to our dedicated and committed faculty who work tirelessly for the success of our students and the university. Please join me in thanking them. I'd also like to recognize Georgia Heron, the class of 1946. Ms. Heron.
Beautiful day for a convocation today. The bright sunshine is out. The clouds, although they're supposed to give us rain, haven't started to do that yet. So it's a time for us to celebrate and to begin a new year. This whole theme is about new beginnings, and this is the first beginning for the new school year, the convocation. Before I go into introducing the speaker, President Mason, I would like to acknowledge, and I know Dr. Petty acknowledged the board members, but if I could have them stand again, if I could, and I'll introduce them one by one. For those of you who don't know them, these are the folks who work with me very hard, and they deserve for you to see who they are and their names. There's Trustee Felton, Trustee Dyke, Trustee Barrington, our student trustee who works really hard, Trustee Wilhite, and then Trustee Schwartz, and I thank them for being here. Last year when I came for convocation, I remember having all kind of barriers to getting here, and I talked about the barriers that tried to make me turn around and go home, and I just refused to stop, and I kept coming, and I eventually got here, and everything was all right. Today, the theme is Journey to 2020. And I remember when my godchildren were little, and I had, you know, 8 godchildren. For some reason, I don't know why, because I must have been crazy, but 8 godchildren. And I would take 4 or 5 of them and pile them up in the car, and we were going to go on a trip. The kids never asked me where we were going. They just knew that they were going in the car with Gami, and it was going to be fun no matter what we did. I would get them in the car and pile them in, and they would be like children, and I'd try to come up with games to keep them quiet. So we would play stuff like license plates. I know some of you have played that game, and punch buggy. There are probably some young folks who don't know what punch buggy was. And then I'd have to stop playing punch buggy because, of course, they would start hitting each other too hard. And I couldn't reach them in the back seat, you know, like you used to be able to do. And so we'd have to come up with something else. Sometimes they would get tired and fidgety, but they always wanted to stay with me to see what the end of our journey would be. Sometimes we would take a wrong turn or two, yet they never asked to go home. They were going to stick it out with Gami no matter what. And I remember one time in particular, we had driven for a long time, and I looked at the gas gauge, and my gas gauge said 0 gas, 0 miles. That meant I wasn't supposed to be going any further. So I started praying, Lord, please don't let me run out of gas with these kids in the car. And I remember finding the gas station, and we got gas. The kids cheered. And my godson, whom some of you have met, said after we got out, he didn't say, Gami, take me home now. What he said was, Gami, I was not going to push no car. So they stayed, and we continued, and we had several adventures like that. No matter where we ended up, whether it was to pick up sharks' teeth on the beach or going to the farm so they could see what it was like to milk cows and to pick stuff. You know, when they were little kids, they don't mind doing stuff like that. Or whether we went for walks in the woods, it was all about the journey, all about the adventure. And despite everything, no matter what we faced, they hung in there with me until we got to the end of that journey. As an adult, I travel quite a bit, and there's nothing more annoying to me than to be delayed in my travels. When I'm ready to go somewhere, I want to go. And I hate it when I'm sitting there, the plane is supposed to be there, and I hear this dreaded announcement that says, our flight is delayed because we're waiting for the crew to get here. And I know that's going to be a long time for us to wait. Well, today, UDC is on a journey. And like my godchildren, some of us are very excited about what this journey is. I can feel the excitement in the air. Some of us have grown a little weary because we've stopped and started, and we haven't yet reached the finish line. Some, like me, just wanted the crew to get here so we could take off and go. Well, today, I heard the announcement. I hope you heard the same one that I did. The crew is here, and they're ready to take us to the end of this journey. While we know that there may be fits and starts like we've always had, there are going to be some barriers in the way, I believe that the crew we have in place is ready to take us there. And the pilot for that crew is President Ronald Mason. He has the capability, he has the skills, he has the knowledge to take us to Journey 2020. And not only will he take us there, but eventually, when we've gone through the barriers, when we have faced all of the hurdles, when we've put everything in place, I'm asking you guys to be patient with us as we go through this journey, to come on the journey with us. Don't sit back, don't criticize, but jump in and help us as we go on the journey together. Because at the end of the day, when we reach Destination 2020, we all can look back and be proud of what we accomplished. I'm not going to read Mr. Mason's bio. That's in the program for you. But I am going to ask him to come out now and to share with you how he proposes to take all of us with him on Journey 2020. Mr. Mason.
Good morning, everyone. I hope everybody's doing well today. I'm double electronic. I got this in one hand, a pointer in the other, trying to keep up with the millennials, you know? First, thank you for letting me speak today. I asked to speak because we have a lot of work to do this year, and I didn't want to waste any time, so this will be a working session. We're going to tell you what we have in mind in terms of the goals and priorities for the upcoming year, the leadership, and we'll post it so that we can get your comments before we settle on the path that we want to take over the course of the next year. We looked at Journey 2020, at Vision 2020, and while it was a pretty good vision that you all put together, we felt like what was missing was how to get there. So we spent a lot of time trying to figure out what is necessary in order for us to be able to achieve the goals set out in that vision. Let's see if the point is working. But then, because this was such a tough crowd, you know, usually if you do these Steve Jobs kinds of things, it's a pre-selected audience, but you're not that. Your students, your faculty, your staff, so it's a tough crowd to have a message that resonates with everybody. So I did something that I don't usually do. I did a draft of a PowerPoint and I presented it to the board at their retreat, giving them an idea of where we were going and sort of testing it out. And they tore it to shreds. The old school folks said it was too, you know, I thought I was pretty up to speed. I had a lot of transition slides with things moving in and things moving out. Said it was too confusing, but the millennials said that there weren't enough pictures because the millennial crowd is not that much into words, but they are into the visuals, right? So Theo over here, Theo, you want to stand up for a second? Our student rep on the board said he would help me put it together. But I figured, you know, if all they want is pictures, I can stick some pictures in there. So I went and stuck some pictures in the thing. And I figured that'd be enough for the millennials. And besides, I ran out of time. I didn't get a chance for him to help me out. So we got pictures here, right? But then when I went home this weekend, because I do parental care on every end of every month in New Orleans, and I got to thinking about what was in that original slide, right? And I got into a conversation with my mom, who was a cook at the YWCA in New Orleans for about 30 years. And the YWCA had a program for abused mothers and children. And, you know, when you sit with your old parents, my mom was 86, you know, they start to remember things. And she started relating stories about the children and the women that came into that program and the kinds of challenges they had. And I was really struck by something that she had never mentioned to me before. And then about 3 weeks ago, I had to go home for a funeral for a young man who was in a program for young black men that we started down at Southern. And he was a Katrina child who had moved around, really had a lot of challenges in life, but stuck with it, showed up every day. And then when he was on the verge of graduating in 5 years, he was in the wrong place at the wrong time and got killed. And it really broke my heart because he was sort of like my poster child for the program. And then the Pope came through, and his message of salvation and redemption and hope was something that is hard to put aside. And then to wrap it all up, this was a football weekend, and I'm in a fantasy league with my family, right? And just so you'll know, my nephew was beating me by 35 points going into last night's game, and Aaron Rodgers was my quarterback. So if you all watch football, you know he had 5 touchdowns, and I needed 35, and he got me 38, so that's a victory for the home team. Now, I had to figure out what approach I wanted to take and which one of these insightful moments in my life I would use to demonstrate what I wanted to get done today. And, you know, being the intelligent, well-read person that I am, I settled on using, after much consternation, I settled on using football as a metaphor in sports that I wanted to go with. And I actually changed the name of the presentation. Instead of Journey to 2020, I think we're going to roll with today winning in 2020, building a championship team. And if you don't recognize this group, anybody recognize this group? Give them a hand. Yeah. We have champions among us. This is our 2014 championship, women's girls basketball champions. So what we're going to cover today, give me a second here, is how to build a championship team. And we're going to talk about things like what our goal is, and our goal is the Super Bowl of higher education, what it means to have a home field and protecting your home field, recruiting the talent that you need to win, developing that talent, having the leadership in place to get the job done, locking down the fundamentals before you move on to the more sophisticated, complicated areas, what the character of a champion should look like, how to measure success, and then how we motivate ourselves to excel. So, let's go first to the goal. Eyes on the prize. By 2020, this is where we expect to be. 4,000 FTE. That translates into about 6,000 headcount. It's a stretch, but young Mr. Sanchez tells me we can get it done. 25% blended graduation rate. Right now we're at about, 16%. $45,000 average salary 10 years out for students who receive financial aid from the federal government. Right now, the national average is about 34, and we're at about the national average. But we not only want to offer credentials of value in the labor market and in life, but we also want to bind our graduates together by a culture of enlightened self-interest. And the best way I can explain it is to quote Pope Francis when he said, "The world tells us to seek success, power, and money, but God tells us to seek humility, service, and love." And I ran into the Pope at a happy hour while he was here, just coincidentally. And I ran our plan by him in the vision and his quote, and he was like, "Go Firebirds," right? So our mission is blessed, is the way I figure it. Now, our home field is the community of the District of Columbia, right? Which I love being here, by the way. I think it's a great place to live and work. And why wouldn't it be? The nation's capital with aspirations of being a fully sustainable environment. Federal, it's a federal city, which means that we have dual economic drivers, a lot of opportunity. It's affluent, $445,000, $100,000 average home value, and it's thriving. Over the past 4 years, the population has grown 10%. But the tale of the district is actually a tale of two cities. Because this is the other district that we live in. In case you can't tell, those are people on benches with all of their belongings in a park in the District of Columbia. The income and wealth inequality is remarkable. the top fifth earns an average of 20 times more than the income of the bottom fifth. Our poverty rate is higher than the average for the nation, and the unemployment disparity between and rate between the races, white and black, 2.7% unemployment on the one hand, 17% on the other. But this is the home field we play in. The talent that we recruit, of course, is our students, members of the ultimate Firebird Nation. And here's what they look like, in case you haven't read the fact book, which is posted online. Broken down by the college and the community college, head count 5286, but the FTE is 3470. That's because 56% of our students are part-time students on a blended basis. 81% come from the district, 46% from three wards in the district. We tend to be a little older. We're 55 and 66% African American, but remarkably and notably, we're 10% international, which is unusual and good from an educational point of view. Our workforce group touches 2,424 lives, but they come to us almost 60% unemployed. And we award those many certificates. The land grant touches 35,000 lives, awards 1,207 certificates. But this is to be noted. Now, our first-time freshmen are really a small portion of first-time and college freshmen, small portion of our enrollment. The retention rate for them is around 50%, and our graduation rate needs some work. This is the national report card, which is, whether you like it or not, it's there. This is what the people are going to read when they come to make decisions about where to send or where to attend. And our cost is actually a little below average. Our salary, as I mentioned before, is about average for the nation 10 years out. But our graduation rate here, that line is the national average, and you can see where we are. This is the community college, nationally underrepresented minorities, excuse me, at about a 34% clip, and we're at about a 7% clip. The next component is the leadership of the team, and I thought this was a great quote. We don't come here to fear the future, we come to shape it. And of course you recognize, I ran into him at happy hour too, just so you know. And he passed this on to me. And here they are, the Board of Trustees led by Dr. Elaine Kreider, who you've met and introduced me. And then there's me and the leadership team here of servant leaders, Dr. Petty, Dr. Epps, Dr. Phillips, Mr. Stovall, Ms. Bates. And if you're not reporting to one of these people, or you're not sure who you report to, you need to figure it out. We'll be sending out memos and org charts and that sort of stuff. But everything leads to one of these folks at the end of the day. In fact, you know, they're wanted individuals. Because we want them to take the reins and provide us the service and the leadership that we need to get where we need to go. Not a bad looking group, though. Now, very handsome. So the next piece is fundamentals. You have to lock down the fundamentals before you move on to the other things that have to happen to win a championship. Now, Theo, I'm very proud of this slide, and this is why. Hit it, Mike. Check it out. So you got to know your assignment. You have to stay in your lanes. You have to follow your blockers. And you protect that student all the way at the end of the day to the goal line. Huh? You know what? Hit it again, Mike. I like that. The whole point is we work to reach that goal at the end of the day of a bachelor's degree. Boom. Oh, went too fast. Just a sec. Got to get back one, I think. So, wait. Okay, here we go. So we have 10 things that we have to get done before we can get the other things done. And here's what they are, and here's who's responsible. We have to lock down middle states. We have to lock down Title IV. We have to lock down our union contracts in a productive way. Organize the system-wide office of student support. That is a division devoted to assisting students when they walk in the door and working with them until they walk out of the door. Assess and coordinate the academic program system-wide. Organize a system-wide office of shared services. It's efficient, it's modern, it's the way we need to go. Show people where we're going to be over the course of the next 3 years financially so that we can go out and pitch it both to the private and the public sector. Assess, update, and organize policies and procedures. We had a big conversation at the cabinet level about holding people accountable, but we realized we couldn't hold them accountable until we had something to hold them accountable to. So we're going to get this piece straight. Get this piece straight in short order. Modernize the business processes. Now, this is as much about technology as anything else, but the thing to remember about technology is that the technology does what it does. It's the business processes and the people that have to use the technology to the best of the technology's ability. So we're going to be focusing on that. And then our brand. You know we have brand challenges. I think it's gotten a little better in the last couple of years, but this is something that we're going to work on because the perception is not up to the reality of where we are as an institution. And then, moving too fast. And then championship character. I just thought I'd give some props to Yogi Berra. You know, a man of, and it really ain't over till it's over. So we're gonna win this championship. And here's the characters of an institution that leads in what we're trying to get done. Strong leadership and culture around student outcomes. Guided learning pathways. You heard me talk about the division that's devoted to that. Intentional focus on improving teaching and learning. Strategic data use to improve practice and close equity gaps. That means we don't just cherry pick who we help on the path to success. We help everybody get there. And then partnerships and structures aligned to define student outcomes, and those are relationships that we have within and outside of the institution. And then how do you measure success? Because it is a game of inches. And this is it. Learning outcomes, completion outcomes, labor market outcomes, equity and outcomes, both in terms of absolute performance, but also in terms of improvement over time. And I want to give some props to Josh Weiner, who is on our board, and he leads the Aspen Institute of College Excellence Program at the Aspen Institute. He did a presentation at the board retreat, and we're going to be working with him as we thrash out the details of this approach. And then keys to victory. Yeah, see that? You see what that is, right? Yeah. Hope springs eternal. I started to put the Redskins up there, but I'm not quite there yet, just so you know. So me and Evola Bates are still hanging on to the fleur-de-lis. But the key to victory, and this is an important slide, I want you to notice this. This is a school that is known for having raised its graduation rates dramatically. But the point here is that if you look at the darker green bars, that is their retention rate, freshman to sophomore retention rate, right? But they couldn't raise the graduation rate until they paid attention to the second bar, which is whether or not that student moved from freshman to sophomore year in the process of being retained. That's the key. It's not about whether they re-register for the second semester. It's about whether they register as sophomores at the end of their freshman year. And we'll be focused heavily on this. And then, what's the motivation? You know, why do most people want to go when they die? Family Feud says heaven, right? Now, here's the point of it all. Here is the point. These are the founding fathers, right? And these are the guys that designed the nation. And through no fault of their own, they designed the nation to look like what they thought it ought to look like. And if you notice the group, there's three things they all have in common. One is that they're of European descent, two is that they're wealthy, and three is that they're men, okay? And so it's not coincidental that As they put together this great nation of ours, they left three things that had to be resolved by future generations. And that was issues of class, issues of race, and issues of gender, right? Because when they designed America, they designed it to look like what they thought it ought to look like. And what do you think they thought it ought to look like? That picture. So any boardroom, all rooms of power in this country are generally going to look like that picture. But it's our job to prove the simple proposition, right? That even if, when they made that decision 200 years ago to set up the system that we have today, even if it made sense from a business point of view back then, right? The truth is that in a modern world, in a globally competitive world, the system that they set up wastes too much human capital. It's expensive to maintain. It puts fear and crime on our doorstep. And it really doesn't work in a globally competitive environment. So our job as an institution is to prove the simple proposition that the choice that they made between justice, which they put on the side in order to engage in the work that they thought was necessary to preserve the nation, that that simple decision that they made was wrong back then. Can't second guess them. It was a business decision. But the truth is that the right decision, looking back on it, would have been that justice is self-preservation. And if you listen to what, that's good, that's worth it, yeah. And if you understand what the Pope is saying, this is basically it. You know, look at what's happening to the world, look at what's happening to the people that we're leaving behind, look at the process that we're engaged in and projected out 20 years, and if we don't understand that we have to bring justice into the equation, then our self-preservation really will be in question. So, if we can do all of those things, let me just recap here, because I think I covered it all. Let me just recap. We know what our goal is by 2020. We know our home field. We know the talent we've recruited. We know the work we have to do to develop the talent. We know who our servant leaders are. We know how to lock down and what the fundamentals are. The character of a champion is something that we discussed. We know how to measure success, and we know how to motivate ourselves to excel so that at the end of the process, what we hope to be is the University of the District of Columbia, an advanced public system of higher learning that serves the community of the District of Columbia. Or, as young Ms. Ford would say, the University of the District of Columbia, the university where dreams come true.
Thank you, President Mason, for your passion and your words of encouragement and your leadership. It's really been a pleasure over the last several months to get to know President Mason. I probably heard him use more words this morning than I have during that entire time, because he is really a man of few words. But his message is powerful. And I'm certain that faculty and staff will embrace the leadership, the servant leadership that he proffers. At this time, I'd like to welcome back the UDC Chorale. The chorale will perform Glory from the movie Selma, featuring UDC students John Stevens, Lonnie Lynn, and Chai Smith.
Oh, glory. passion and dream. You're gonna need a snatch it by any necessary means.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours. It will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won.
Convocation a memorable occasion. I hereby declare the convocation ended.